Excellent. So we will begin, and Yuval will join us a bit later. Welcome everyone to the workshop of the Federman Cybersecurity Research Center, the law program. We are delighted to host, to have with us today, two friends of the center and members of the center, Katrina Liget from the engineering and computer science faculty, and Ayelet Gordon Tapiro, which originated from the law faculty, but now is interdisciplinary between faculties. We look forward to hear your presentation and to discuss it. And I will not waste any more of your precious time. Thank you very much for taking the time to present your research.
All right, so let's start by sharing our screen. The obligatory, you know, getting organized. Can you see my presentation? Okay, fantastic. So Tad, thank you very much. It's great to be here and to present this paper today. This is a joint project with Katrina, who you just introduced, and with Alex from the Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society at Harvard University. And as part of a broader project, which is part of the co-ops group, which is an interdisciplinary group of researchers, which we are also very happy to welcome today. And so let's start. I don't think that to this group of people, I have to advocate the basic premise of this paper. And that is that the data ecosystem is severely broken. Some really problematic cases of personalization and how data was mistreated and misused have made their way into very, very mainstream media. And so if in the past it was just, you know, our type of people who were aware of the challenges, now basically everybody knows like how bad things are. And a really big question to stop and ask is, how did we get here? How did things get so bad? And then once we sort of think about that question, we can move on to thinking about what we can do to fix things and to make things better. Now, to understand how we got to the point where platforms can create all of these harms that, you know, you've just seen, we should start by understanding the incentives of platforms and the structure of the data ecosystem that unfortunately has not just enabled these harms, but is a real big driving force in creating them. Platforms' main source of income is derived from personalized advertising, right? The big service that they're able to provide is to present the right ad to the right person at the right time. And let's see how they're able to do this. So the main actors in the data ecosystem are platforms and users. And at this point, we're quite accustomed to thinking about the flow of data between, from users to platforms, which we call the outgoing vector. Along this vector, platforms collect data about their users, basically any type of data that you can think of that flows from users to platforms. So it includes who they interact with, what groups they're part of, what pages they've liked, and also information outside the platform. So it includes both interaction between users and platforms, users and other users, and also individuals outside the platform. Like what websites we've visited, what, you know, online shops we shop at, what it is that we like buying, and sometimes even offline information such as our location data. So for example, when you visit a page that has the little, you know, Facebook icon, Facebook knows that you visited that page whether or not you've clicked on the icon. And that's information that's collected on the outgoing vector, information that platforms collect about their users' activity. Now, this vector raises a whole bunch of questions pertaining to individual consent to the data collection, privacy protections, what data is collected, what data is stored, how it's stored, how long it's stored for, data processing, and all these terms that we've become quite accustomed to using. Platforms collect this data, they store it, they train machine learning models on it, and sometimes they share the data itself or derivatives of it with third parties. By the way, you can request a copy of all the outgoing vector content that the platform has collected about you. Just brace yourself and don't freak out too much. Now, one of the things that platforms do with all of this outgoing vector data is to draw a very, very detailed profile of their users. Who we are, what we're interested in, who we interact with, where we go. And the more outgoing vector data a platform is able to collect about a user, the more detailed a profile it can draw about that particular user. Now, we could ask ourselves, why is it so important for platforms to be able to create such a detailed profile of their users, right? And the answer has to do with the other flow of content from platforms to users in what we call the incoming vector. Okay, so we're taking the point of view of the user itself, and therefore what goes from the user to the platform is outgoing, what comes from the platform to the user is incoming. And along this vector, platforms present their users with personalized content, okay? This includes basically every aspect of our online interaction, the order in which our newsfeed is presented, a reminder to wish your friend happy birthday, suggestions for other content that you might find interesting, and the most famous and definitely the most profitable for platforms is personalized advertising. Now, the more time a user spends on the platform, the more incoming vector content she can be presented with. And the more she interacts with that incoming vector content, the more outgoing vector data she provides for the platforms to collect about her. So we can see that this is sort of a cycle that feeds itself. In order to maintain this cycle, right, the platform needs to sort of keep this going. Platforms want to be sure that what they're presenting us on the incoming vector is not just something that we're going to look at or scroll past. They want to make sure that it's something that we're going to engage with, because the more engagement we create, the more outgoing vector data we are generating for the platform. And unfortunately, what platforms have found that is that the type of content that creates the most engagement and encourages people to interact the most is content that's inflammatory, divisive, and increasingly extreme. So really briefly, the result of the structure that I just described and the incentives is a whole bunch of what we call incoming vector harms. Okay, things like addiction, extremism and polarization, disinformation that's presented to users, a filter bubble reality that we are, you know, closed into, dark patterns, discrimination, but also other types of unfair personalization. And more generally speaking, platforms now have the ability to manipulate us in a way that impacts our individual autonomy. Now, I do want to say that some of these harms aren't what we call personalized harms, right? Addiction measures that are supposed to encourage addiction and dark patterns are things that are harmful even if they're not personalized, but can be made much worse if platforms are able to personalize these features. And in any case, our focus in this paper is on personalization-driven harms. So before I describe the data ecosystem and the flow of content within it as if a platform interacts with a user, but the truth is, but a really important characteristic of the data ecosystem is that platforms don't interact with only one user, right? They interact with many, many users. And so the platforms interact with these many users, as I said, along two vectors. So content flows from the platform to the user and from the user to the platform. But another really important aspect of the data ecosystem is that users interact among themselves, okay? And this creates a very, very important characteristic of the data ecosystem or of data within it, and that is that data is very, very much collected. And that's true in several respects. First, it's true because some of the platforms that we talk about, though we absolutely acknowledge that not all of them, are by their very nature supposed to encourage interaction with other people. Okay, as you can see, people interact with each other, and that's what generates content and sort of value also to some of these platforms. But that's not the only way in which data is collected. Let's say, for example, that somebody posts a picture, right? The picture is theirs in a certain respect, and then I am tagged in that picture. How does that then change the nature of the picture or the data within the picture, it now pertains not only to the person who has posted it, but maybe also to the person who was tagged in it, maybe also the person who actually did the tagging. So in that context, it's not right. There's no way to talk about data as either being mine or being yours. It's much more precise to talk about data as being ours, as being collective. And another way in which data is collective, at least from the platform's point of view and the way that they're structured, is that by analyzing the behavior of large groups of users, platforms can infer the characteristics of particular users, even if they've not provided them. And let's just look at an example. So we have a user here who has decided for whatever reason to withhold their gender, okay? So question mark has decided not to disclose their gender to the platform. It turns out that there are certain aspects of language use that are characteristic of either male or female users. So the platform knows a lot of information about a whole bunch of users, and then it can sit down and analyze the language patterns used by certain users. So let's say it finds common language patterns to people belonging to the red group, okay? Because of all of the outgoing vector data that the platform collected, it also knows that these people belonging to the red group are predominantly female. And therefore it sort of can detect a correlation between this type of language use and the gender of the people who use it. Let's say that people belonging to the purple group are have similar language patterns, similar to themselves, not similar to the red group, and have been found to be predominantly male. Now let's go back to our user who has decided not to disclose their gender. And the platform can analyze that user's language patterns, discover that those language patterns are very much in line with those of people belonging to the red group, and can then infer that that user is indeed female. And I think this is a good place to stop and say that some inferences or some forms of personalization are really helpful for us, right? It might be really helpful for us to get a recommendation of like a pizza place that's near us or a suggestion for a product that we might want to buy. And sometimes those inferences can help us. But generally speaking, those inferences can be really, really problematic. Somebody purposely has withheld their gender or their sexual orientation, and platforms act in order to infer them, it could be very, very problematic. And this example also shows us another ramification of the fact that data is collective, or another aspect in which data is collective. And that is that basically no single individual can decide to withhold their data on their own, right? It just means nothing. This user has decided not to provide certain data, and yet because of the nature of platforms, because of the collective nature of data, the platform was able to infer that characteristic, despite her maybe actually actively deciding not to disclose that information. Now, all these events and these characteristics have not escaped the attention of regulators. And in recent years, regulators actually all around the world have been giving more and more thought to these issues of incoming vector harms, and incoming, in particular, harms stemming from platforms' ability to personalize content. These are the main categories of regulatory approaches toward incoming vector harms within the United States. And I'd like to stop here and sort of say, if anybody is aware of other types of regulation, whether proposals or existing laws that address incoming vector personalization, please feel free to share them with us, drop them in the chat box here, or reach out to any of us. We're focusing on policy proposals that I'm going to describe now that deal with incoming vector personalization harms. And because of time constraints, I'm only gonna discuss two central tools, but I do feel that I wanna stop first and say a word about privacy, because this is something that we're all very, very much concerned with and is an important point before we go into the details of the proposed regulatory approaches. So we know that in recent years, there's been a wave of privacy protection regulation, right? Things like the GDPR, CCPA, CPRA, and similar regulations all around the world. Now, if to go back to the terminology that I presented in the beginning, using our terminology, privacy protection has its main role in regulating outgoing vector data, right? Things like learning whether a controller has been collecting or processing my data, limits on data collection and processing, the right to ask for deletion of data that has been collected or rectification of data, as well as things like data portability, all have to do with outgoing vector content. And we want to acknowledge that these rights have had, you know, an enormous impact and have basically changed the way that we think about privacy and privacy protection. At the same time, in the context of incoming vector content, providing individuals with control or with protections regarding their outgoing vector content has very, very limited ability to help regarding overcoming incoming personalization harm. First, because as we saw, we don't really need you to provide your data in order for us to know a whole lot of things about you. We can infer it based on data provided by other individuals. And so the question of your consent or willingness to have your data collected or analyzed is a very limited, you know, help in this context. And second, because even if I've agreed to have my data collected and processed for one purpose or not for the other, that doesn't say anything about what type of personalization or what type of incoming vector content I'm willing to accept. So before we go into the details, I just want to say that we evaluate these regulatory proposals based on basically two central tools or two central criteria. The first is whether the tools proposed will actually enable the regulator or us as a society to overcome these harms. And the second criteria that we look at is whether, which is sort of connected to the first, of course, is whether the proposal adopts a collective point of view. And of course, one has to do, one impacts the other. In a successful intervention, we'll have to adopt a collective point of view. And if it does so, it is more likely to be able to deal with the harms that it wants to. So, one set of tools that's advanced by various policy proposals is an effort to increase individuals' control over their incoming vector content. And this is done by requiring platforms to disclose certain information to users and ask for their consent to be presented with certain content. So let's see an example. The Detour Act mandates that platforms tell their users that they're running experiments on them and allow the users to opt out of being part of these experiments. Now, the main concern with experiments, and I think what inspired this piece of regulation or this proposal was the Facebook emotions experiment, is the fear that if we're included in these experiments without having consented to them, it could be a substantial manipulation to the point, again, where it impacts our individual autonomy. So that's the concern of the Detour Act. The Filter Bubble Transparency Act sort of looks to address a different type of harm, that of platforms creating a filter bubble, presenting us with content that just reaffirms things that we already believed in, and sort of pushing out or not presenting us, actively not presenting us, with content that could challenge our beliefs or, you know, bring us to a conversation with people who think different than us. So the Filter Bubble Transparency Act requires the platform to disclose to its users that they're being presented with content that has been generated by an algorithm. And it requires platforms to enable users to opt out of that algorithmically generated newsfeed. So a similar approach, by the way, to the Filter Bubble Transparency Act is adopted by the EU Digital Services Act. This concept of, you know, letting users know what's going on and allowing them to opt out. Let's talk a little bit more about consent, okay? When we say consent, what are we actually talking about? We're talking about individuals being presented with a standard form contract on a take it or leave it basis with literally zero ability to influence any of the terms in it. And usually, individuals have to agree to the terms of service in order to be active on the platform. Now, the way that it's implemented, it's very hard to call, you know, that type of mechanism consent, definitely not one that enables individuals increased control over what's done with their data or what they're presented with. First of all, because most people won't even open up the terms of service. Those who will realize the huge mistake that they've done, will close it immediately without even reading it. And those who do bother reading it may not understand the language and may not understand the legal ramifications of what they're reading. So for example, if I've read that, you know, we have a mandatory arbitration clause, what does that mean? How does that limit my legal rights? What kind of things am I giving up here? And if we think about the structure of the data ecosystem, not only are all these problems, you know, very prevalent, but basically users don't really have a choice, right? If I want to go into a photo sharing platform, basically the only thing I can do is agree to whatever Instagram requires of me. And so these are things that we all have to think about when we say control is going to, you know, consent is going to be able to provide individuals with more control. Now, in the context of incoming vector personalized content, there's another problem, and that is that I can't really know whether my consent or lack of consent was respected, right? Let's say I'm being presented with certain content. There's really very little way for me as an individual to know whether this content has been algorithmically generated, whether this content is being presented to me as part of experiment. So I really can't know, in as much as we're talking about my interaction with the platform, I have very limited ability to know this. And most importantly in our context is that the tool of disclosure and consent is very much an individualistic tool. It fails to recognize the fact that data is very much collective and the fact that my decision can definitely impact the decision of my connection. So let's just think of a case where I've opted out of being part of an experiment, but my 50 connections have not. So I may, best case scenario, the platform is not going to present me with content that's part of this experiment. But the moment that one of my connections interacts with this type of platform, by virtue of my you know, social connection to them, I could very well find myself being exposed to this content. And so the bottom line is that giving individual tools cannot effectively overcome the challenges created by incoming vector personalization. It just can't. Having said that, we do recognize that individual control is a very important aspect of our activity in the data ecosystem. And we do think that any effort to overcome the challenges of incoming vector personalization should respect individual control, and the tool for doing so may just have to be consent. What we do think is that we have to change the way that we think about consent, and we have to rethink the options provided to individuals so that people understand what they're deciding, it has meaning, and they have substantial options to choose from, so that it's not just give your consent or, you know, get out of the data ecosystem. Another tool that appears in several regulatory proposals is that of transparency increasing mechanisms. Then, while we were talking first about disclosure in the context of platforms disclosing information to the user, here we're talking about broader transparency and the platforms basically disclosing information to third parties, not to the users themselves. And these acts mandate that platforms disclose this information. So for example, the Honest Ads Act requires disclosure about political ads, creating a database that's publicly accessible. The Social Media Data Act requires platforms to provide researchers like us with information about all ads presented on them, and not just the ads, but a whole bunch of details regarding the ad. And while there are definitely certain tweaks that we would like to see with the exact details of what kind of information is disclosed and et cetera, we definitely think that providing a trusted third party, and we appreciate being that trusted third party, with information about both incoming vector and outgoing vector content will allow people like us or that trusted third party to carry out a really important role in this context, such as detecting patterns of personalization, right? So the platform sort of detects patterns of common attributes that the users have, but if we try to look at the other side, we would be able to see common patterns of personalization. And another reason why we think that transparency increasing mechanisms, at least in the way that they're now proposed, has a greater chance of actually achieving the goal of overcoming incoming vector personalization, again, is that it creates a collective point of view. And so now we come to our proposal. And we suggest introducing a new actor into the data ecosystem, that of an intermediary, which would sit between platforms and users. We do acknowledge that a lot of the tools in policy proposals and in existing regulation are important and serve important purposes. We would definitely want to build on them. We think that we need to add an additional layer that would have a collective perspective into the data ecosystem. And the intermediary, in order to be successful and in order to effectively allow us to overcome these harms, would have to have access to both outgoing and incoming vector content in order to be able to identify cases of personalization. And maybe I should have started with this, but we recognize and we call upon like all these policy proposals to recognize that an intermediary or any kind of body that gets integrated into the data ecosystem and works with data has to adopt a privacy-first perspective. There's no way that such an intermediary, there's no way that such a body could function if formal privacy is not a very, very, very top priority for it. And by the way, it's interesting that one of the existing proposals, the Social Media Data Act, already recognizes differential privacy as an important tool that would be that would serve an important role in protecting the data that's being disclosed to researchers. Now, because of the unique position that this intermediary would hold within the data ecosystem, it would be able to perform three central roles. The first is it would be able to detect personalization. So I know what appears in my, you know, social media or in my proposals for things that I may want to shop for, but I don't know what you guys are seeing. And so this collective point of view that would be created by an intermediary would be able to say, okay, different people are seeing different things. The second thing it would be able to do is to identify correlations. I don't think that we have a problem per se with people seeing different things. The problem is that the personalized content is being personalized in a systematic way. And so this intermediary, because it would have both outgoing and incoming vector content, it would be able to detect, for example, that certain job ads were presented predominantly to white males, while other job offerings were presented predominantly to, say, Black females. And the last thing that the intermediary would be able to do in this context would be to address these harms of personalization, or basically to enforce any type of norm that we would want it to enforce. It could either block certain content or flag certain content, and by that sort of help us overcome some of it. Now, in the future, the intermediary could do other things also that require collective action. So it could be in a position to negotiate with platforms on behalf of its members. It could get better privacy protections for its members. All these things that require collective action that now as individual users, we have no chance of achieving. And we do think that regulation will have an important role. We're not suggesting to completely get rid of that. We think regulation would be able to do really important things like creating the intermediary or having a say in the character of the intermediary. Is it a private entity? Is it a public entity? About the internal governance of it. And it would also be able to encourage or strongly encourage or force platforms and users to interact with each other through such an intermediary. Now, I'm just going to sum up by saying that technologists tell us that the technology to create such an intermediary exists. And so while we definitely recognize that there are a lot of questions that still have to be thought through, we think that the conversation now should definitely be about how we meaningfully design such an intermediary while understanding that it has a really strong potential to substantially change the power structure of the data ecosystem and to empower individuals and to allow us to address these harms of personalization that to a certain extent have gone out of control. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ayelet. Katrina, you want to add something before we open the floor for discussion?
No, I'll just participate in the Q&A. Thank you, that was great.
Okay, so the floor is officially open for a discussion.
Wait, Kyle, I think I should stop sharing, but I think.
You can. I can also stop your share.
Yeah, if you could stop, that would be great. Fantastic, thank you.
At your service. perfect. So we had some questions in the chat. You want to address them before we begin? Oh.
I haven't had a chance to read them, so maybe we'll.
I saw something from Froike, and I saw that Katrina replied to it. But if you want to also refer to it orally,
so give me a second.
Sure, I can start since I had the advantage of being able to watch the chat as you were speaking. So Falka mentioned that it's not just platforms that are doing inference, and in fact, researchers also routinely do inference. So, example, if you gather data, some of the data is missing. You do your best to infer the missing data, and whether that sort of falls under the scope of the discussion we're having today. And my response, and maybe you want to add something to that, Ayelet, was to say that for now we're focused here on the inference that's being done by platforms, which then forms the basis of personalized content coming on the incoming vector, which sort of feeds into this sort of cycle of harms that you were talking about. It's not to say that there aren't problematic inferences done in other contexts and that there aren't similarities, but that this is really our focus for now. But maybe you wanted to add something to that response.
Yeah, I think, I absolutely agree with what Katrina said. And I also think that platforms are in a position that we as researchers are not in, right? We don't have all of this outgoing vector content that we're able to collect. We don't have what we have as researchers is what, you know, the participants have provided us with. And we don't have this whole net of understanding of people's social interactions. And I think that has a substantial difference, or makes a substantial difference in their able to, in platforms' ability to infer, first of all, on the robustness of what they've inferred. And second, on the extent of the amount of inferences about personal attributes that they can do. There's just no end.
And then, of course,
I guess if I can just add to that a little bit, the reason I bring this up is I think thinking about this other context can help sort of sharpen defining the problem that you're really dealing with, right? Because that there is a lot of content to make the inference. I mean, if I have a survey with, you know, tens of thousands of people, or even just a couple of thousands, and let's say a survey as they are done by, you know, the standard of living condition survey in from the World Bank, right, which is done in many, many countries and is an hour and a half long or 2 hours long. I mean, there's a lot of information and probably much better quality information than what the platforms ever get from just looking at patterns, right? Because there's a lot of noise and devices change, users and whatnot. So the survey responses are certainly of better quality. And so if I then have people in there who decide to not disclose certain things, our imputation models can be quite good, you know, to take the patterns from the other people and impute the values. And so I was trying to think, it's like, okay, what is the harm? Well, obviously we think that the output that we generate through the imputation with the aggregated data is not harming an individual, right? But where's the line, right? I mean, from an ethical perspective, you also could say they purposefully did not give me that information. And now I, you know, turn around and take that information from some other place, right? So it seems to me the same ethical concern, except if you sharpen it and say, well, it is the concern starts because what we don't have in the research setting is this feedback loop back to the respondent. So like, you know, I see content tailored to me through others that then shapes my behavior again, or, you know, but I just want to encourage you to sort of think about what is it that makes this kind of inference in that context more harmful than the other kind of, or the same kind or even better inference in another context. That's all why I wanted to bring that up. Yeah.
Thank you, Falka. I think that's a really useful sort of sharpening of the question. My my thought is that I think there are multiple harms going on here. And I think that inference in itself can be a harm. It can be inappropriate in certain conditions, although we don't yet currently have any sort of consensus, I think, as a community about what constitutes acceptable or unacceptable inference. But then there are the harms that these inferences enable, and that's sort of the cycle back that you mentioned. And those personalized content-driven harms are the focus of our study here. But I think you're right that it's worth sort of more carefully separating out the issue that the inference in itself can be problematic. But we're focused here on what the inference enables. Thank you. Yeah, I think we should think more about that.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Gadi would like to join the discussion. Please, Gadi.
First of all, thank you for the wonderful presentation. It's not just empty words. I think a lot of the times when we try to look at the bigger problem, we get lost in the multitude of troubles Facebook and other platforms create, and therefore trying to find a solution. But you did something there that really interests me, and I would like to, if you can elaborate on this. You talked about some sort of, you always go from the personal, which is a privacy infringement, to the collective, right? You say you harm, that the data is not only mine, it becomes some sort of a collective data, which becomes a hurt, because well, the moment you have a picture, you have the data of who took the picture, who's in the picture, and infer a bit in about other people, and you use the data to make conclusions about third parties. So it becomes something you call collective. Now, as a legal scholar, this causes me some sort of really big problem, because I know that rights are very individual in nature. The fact that I do something to a lot of people doesn't make it collective. It just makes it a very effective way. I hurt one by one people. Sorry if my English isn't good enough to transfer this question, but and this is something I would like to know, since I know at least Ayelet from our conversations at least 3 years ago thought like me about individual infringements. So she's saying something the opposite, and I would like to know how did you do this leap from the individual harm to the collective harm? Because the moment you say collective, at least under current law, you give something to the government. The government is the only person who defends the collective. And then therefore the intermediary can only be a national regulator. And then, and you instead want a third party. So I would love to understand this step you make, because I'm saying it's innovative in the best way I can. A lot of scholars innovative if something not very good, but here it's the amazing part, and I would love to just understand how you did that one.
So first of all, thank you, and don't remind me of what I thought 3 years ago. I don't remember what my position was yesterday. Maybe this is a good opportunity to clarify. I don't think we're not saying that the harm is collective. We're saying that data by its very nature has a collective aspect. I think if we sit down and analyze these harms, they're very much toward individuals. Now, I agree with you that they're toward a whole lot of individuals, right? When I get discrimination, I can discriminate against many, many individuals belonging to a certain group. But what has enabled me to discriminate along the incoming vector, what we call the incoming vector, is the fact that data doesn't just pertain to you. I don't think we're talking about legal ownership of data. We're talking about sort of what kinds of things I can learn from the data presented by one individual. It impacts the data of many, many other individuals. I can give you numerous examples. When I send you an email, That's not collective, right? I've sent you the email, but now it sort of has a little bit of my data, but also a little bit of your data. And when I get genetically tested, that was totally my decision, right? My control, my consent, but you know, realizations or my genetic attributes can also impact the data of my cousin, for example. So it's not that the data itself is collective or that God forbid, the harms are collective. The harms are very much individualistic, but the nature of the data sometimes pertains to much more than one individual. Right, Katrina, please feel free.
I would layer upon this, though, that in addition to being concerned about these individual harms that do manifest across many individuals, we also have identified and in our analysis that personalization on the incoming vector really does manifest in societal harms as well. So these issues of sort of widespread mistrust in institutions and in each other, that's not something that's really primarily manifesting at the level of individuals, but it's still incredibly corrosive and problematic. But that's not so much something where we're talking about a right of an entity being violated, but rather, you know, is this a principle that we're willing to stand up for and try to defend, that we would like to avoid this type of a harm? You mentioned something interesting that from your perspective, Gabi, that the government is the only entity that defends the collective. I'm not sure that I agree with that. Of course, I'm not a lawyer, but I think there are many instances of groups of people coming together to defend themselves. I mean, collective organization, you know, labor organization would be an example in my mind. That there are other institutions and other groups that can stand up for a collective. So maybe I misunderstood that point.
In the fact that normally these types of organizations only represent people who are part of these organizations. You have to be part of the labor union in order for them to represent you. Nevertheless, the state of Israel will represent me whether I ask them or not, because they're the government. So that's the only part of the collective which I thought that the government was supposed to take part in. So even though I didn't know that my privacy may have been infringed upon, the government will say, as an Israeli citizen, the Israeli government will come and protect me, even though I didn't ask them. That's what I meant.
Good, thanks. I understand better now.
Thank you very much, Gali. Tomer, please.
Okay, so thank you. It is super interesting, as you know. So first to Gali's question, I think that maybe the answer is to treat data as relational and not collective. There is a lot of, not a lot, but there is some literature who said that data, the relational aspect in data, and the data is relational. So maybe relational would not bring that kind of critique that Gadi brought. And there is something to already exist about this line of thinking. So I think it can contribute. And another issue is that in order that those intermediary could really fulfill their role, they have to have a lot of data and a lot of participants. So it should be collective in this aspect. And then we have the question, one aspect is, so why not the state or somebody else? And the other question, and if not the state, I think we need to, it's opportunity to reimagine the collective or to think of maybe about ad hoc collectives, or I think we should do some work here, because good intermediary will be the largest intermediary, and there's a lot of bias here, because if we have different kind of entities and each entity will have like participants from this or then they couldn't see a lot of things. So one option is using tech like federated learning or other kind of distributed infrastructure in order to do this work. But then we have, and this is, I think it's a good option, but then still we have to answer why not the state, and to do this job through other kind of entity collective, but why not, and it's related to the way that you present it as like alternative to the contemporary new emerging regulation. And I don't think it have to be like this. It's not like alternative, but a way to answer some of the problem of the contemporary regulation.
So if I can begin, I absolutely do not think that this is an alternative. There are a lot of very positive things that come up in regulation, in existing laws and regulatory proposals that we would definitely want to adopt into the design of the intermediary. And so it's definitely not saying, okay, let's get rid of everything that's being suggested now, but let's build on it and see what positive aspects we can take from it and how we would need to complement them in order to create the point of view that we want to achieve. And regarding your question of the exact structure or, you know, would it be government? Honestly, I thank you for that question because I think those are the questions that we should be thinking about. And the aim with presenting, you know, the regulatory proposals that are going on like now in the current Congress in the United States are to say that's not the conversation that's going on. And we definitely think that the type of questions that you just raised are the things that we should be thinking about. We should be thinking about how we design the intermediary, how we integrate it into the system, how we, you know, think about the relationship between different intermediaries. That's where the conversation should be. We should be taking positive insights from current regulatory proposals and existing laws and thinking about how we integrate them into creating this collective perspective, because it's so missing from the other proposals. And it's missing to the point where it's going to undermine their ability to address the harms that they wanted, that they want to address.
Sabrina, you want to add, or?
I think we can continue. I see there are a lot of questions queuing up.
Yeah, absolutely. So the next question will be from Daphna, please.
Hey, thank you very much, Ayala and Katrina, for an excellent presentation. I think you really managed to accurately frame the problem and the idea of conceptualizing data as a collective product is really an interesting direction to think of. And I actually disagree with Gary. I think that it is collective in this, because it wouldn't have worked otherwise. And it wouldn't have the power it has if it was not, if it was established only on the individual. But precisely because of that, I mean, when we talk about inferences data, which is data that is basically not regulated today, as you said, so some scholars really suggested a harm-based approach, which basically means to evaluate the sensitivity of the inferences and whether it involves potential harm. But my question is why, and follow up to Tom, why an intermediate body? Why not? Because because the data is collective, and because of the potential harm, this is supposed to be the exact justification to make regulation stronger on the platforms themselves. So, like, what is the advantage of an intermediate body? And another, it's more of a thought that I had, more than a question, but I think you mentioned it when you talked about the harm of dark pattern, when the data on you is starting to design you, and has personality influences, and then it goes vice versa. I wonder if this should be kind of a different framework. It should be framed other than the problem of the collective data. If it's something else that we need to think of in a different way, because there it's a systemic problem of the way that the system works. So just curious to hear your thought about it. Thanks.
Katrina, do you
want to
address either of those?
Sure, if I can figure out how to unmute myself. Thank you. Thank you for the questions and the comments. So, so you asked sort of why a collective? And my answer is because it seems clear to us that there needs to be an entity that can detect problematic personalization. And you can't see the existence of the problem unless you can see how the personalized content correlates with the attributes of the individuals. So there has to be some entity that has the information accessible to it to see this. If we're going to regulate it, examine it, measure it, stop it, whatever it is, if we want to do something about it, we probably need some insight into the problem. And so we're not taking a sort of clear stance on who exactly this intermediating body should be and how exactly they should function, how they exactly should be governed, but we think it has to exist. Now, I think two natural sort of candidates that immediately come to mind for who, you know, who this body might be are a government entity. And that's certainly a possibility. There are many reasons why this is a natural role for government in protecting people against harms. There are also many reasons why one might hesitate to make this a government body, including issues related to trust in government. Another sort of extreme of where you could place sort of this responsibility would be to try to endow platforms with the responsibility to provide this insight into the relationships between the incoming and the outgoing vectors. And this also has an advantage in that the platforms to some extent have this perspective already. You don't need to build in some sense a new entity and, you know, fund it and run it and provide it with this insight and intervene in the flow of data and the ecosystem. And there's a lot to like about that. And there's a lot to be extremely skeptical about that. Part of the problem is that individual platforms actually don't have a cohesive view of the entire data ecosystem. But beyond that, we have serious concerns about placing this level of responsibility in platforms who are extremely conflicted in their interests. And in many cases really have financial interests that are directly in conflict with the best interests of individuals in society. So we're not saying yes, this, not this for sure, but what we're identifying is the need for some trusted entity that will have this perspective. And we're seeing a lack of such an entity, both in today's reality and in other proposals that we see to try to address these incoming vector concerns.
Ayla, do you want to add something before we move on?
I concur.
Brilliant. So Yuval, please.
Very interesting. I apologize for missing the first few minutes, but I have read this before, as you know. So I kind of like the idea and the general direction of going towards an intermediary. But I mean, it's not just details. I think these are huge, huge questions, which are really about, you know, the governance of basically of this online domain. So I think you make a very important contribution by noting that we have here a gap in terms of a sort of a market failure in identifying and remedying systemic problems. I kind of disagree with Gadi in the sense that it's not just individual rights. I think you have an interest in a functioning, there is a strong public interest in a functioning digital ecosystem, which does not, you know, perpetuate or exacerbate some problems that we used to have in the offline world. So I think it's true that you could, some of these interests would also be translated into individual rights. But I think for me, the better analogy is probably like consumer groups that, you know, that basically look out not only for, you know, the individual wrongs that consumers have suffered, but actually also look at the fairness of consumer practices. But moving from step A to step B is extremely difficult. So one question is, I think the governmental regulation model is gonna, you know, meet up with all the difficulties with do we want governments, you know, to have access to this sort of information? Do we want governments to regulate this sort of activity? And which government? I mean, these services are global. So I don't know how you really come around this. The platforms themselves, self-regulation, I mean, we know what we can think about self-regulation. It's going to be problematic. I mean, we did have an interesting, the Facebook NYU Ad Observatory incident, I think, is quite telling in this regard, because they in a way functioned in ways similar to what you envision, I think, as an intermediary. I mean, they did conduct, I think, bona fide academic research about political ads. And yet Facebook basically threw them off of the platform by actually making the quite interesting claim that they violate the privacy of the users. So you have here, so I think the operation of this apparatus would also raise these sort of issues in the sense, well, I mean, the gathering of information, the analysis of information has itself issues, but there will also be questions about consent, whether users actually want to be part of these overall surveys analysis. So I think actually there would still be incredibly difficult problems in taking it to the next stage. But I really welcome, you know, the fact that you're putting this on the table and that you're encouraging debates about the potential roles of intermediaries in making this environment work better. I think the problem we have is that we do not have good models. I mean, I think maybe part of the challenge would be to identify good models that actually work and could be adjusted to what you are looking at. And here, I mean, maybe this is something we can all work on and think on what could actually work well. I mean, that we know that has, I mean, to some extent, and with this I will conclude, I mean, we did rely traditionally on non-profit groups such as ICANN to provide us with very important services online, but their job was, you know, quite technical and not so confrontational vis-a-vis, individuals and groups with a lot of money at their hands. So actually to apply such a model here would be quite something of a stretch. So it's not really a question, it's more a flow of, a consciousness flow of ideas.
You're sharing collectively the flow of information, so you're applying already the article.
Thanks, Yuval. I think the consumer groups analogy that you offer is a really useful one. And I like a number of the ways that you framed the question, and I can only agree that there are more questions than answers here. But the goal here is really to sort of prompt work on and focus attention on what we view as this gap and the opportunity there to maybe actually make some progress on these issues.
I just want to also follow up on the consumer example, and this also goes back to a certain extent to Daphna's question. Consumer organizations sort of change the equilibrium between consumers and businesses, right? Whereas in the past, it was each consumer sort of fighting on their own with each business. Consumer organizations sort of change that. And the FNAT, to a certain extent, the introduction of an intermediary, which is a trusted body. It's not a body that has, you know, economic incentives, which platforms are very much driven by their strong economic incentives, can change the power structure and can sort of pull users together instead of each user interacting directly with platforms, however regulated they are. Now they sort of have more power together as a collective to interact with them. And that's a substantial change that occurred both in the world of consumer organizations and that we would hope that would happen, you know, in the data ecosystem.
Thank you very much. So our next question will be from Professor Elizabeth Edinburgh. So good morning in New York. Thank you for joining us, and please.
Hi, everyone. So So yeah, so thanks for this. As you know, I'm strongly on board as part of the project too, but I still want to press the thing that you guys have heard from me, I think a number of times. It's along the lines of the last few questions as well, because while I completely agree, obviously, about this need for the attention to the kind of collective nature of the harm and finding some sort of way to address that and shift the balance of power, my persistent worry about data co-ops and creating some third kind of intermediary is kind of the worry about what tends to happen with these types of entities, because of course we can kind of stipulate, well, they are a trusted entity and, you know, they don't have financial incentives, but I think that the trick is gonna be, you know, maybe even initially created on all kinds of good intentions, right? This is how it's gonna be perceived to work. But what tends to happen in these cases is you're gonna have even more information. There's gonna be financial incentives that change. So that the kind of trick of designing it in a way so that we don't just add some entity that becomes, you know, that just reinvents or exacerbates or, you know, any of the things that we can anticipate happening with all of the bad consequences of some entity that has this kind of nuanced information and ability to control that. So not really a new question, but I'm gonna keep asking it probably.
Thanks, and I think it's one we all need to keep asking ourselves. And I think it's part of why this is a space that needs academic treatment, not just sort of action. We don't just need somebody to go and build one of these things, but we need people to think really, really critically about how can one put protections in place when making any sort of intervention in the flow of information in the ecosystem, because there's obviously a real need. My hope is that we have a better chance with something we build than trying to sort of repurpose an existing entity that already has all sorts of flaws and problems and alternative pressures and incentives sort of baked into it. So the hope is that if you get to build the co-ops, you get to write rules and constraints, and you get to sort of build in technical controls. So Kobe was mentioning in the chat about how you can potentially perform the functions of the co-op in an extraordinarily decentralized fashion. There are all sorts of things at your disposal when you're the one who gets to design and build the incentives and the structure and the functioning and the governance. That's not to say that any of these are easy questions, but at least you, in some sense, have the whole vocabulary of tools at your disposal to try to shape the behavior and restrict the behavior of the co-op. And the one thing that I would say, just to sort of make it clear in case it's not obvious, is that I think that what will help such entities really flourish is constraints on their behavior, because that enables them to be more trustworthy, constraints on how they can function and how they're governed and technically what they can do. I think constraints actually are really, really welcome in this space. And so we all need to be thinking collectively about the many, many toolkits and sort of different sort of disciplinary types of constraints that can be offered. Because it's not just going to be technical constraints, it's not just going to be legal constraints, it's going to be a whole package of economic and so on and so forth. And so how do we build that package together?
I will just briefly add that I framed the question as to how did we get here? And I think that's an honest question. I'm not sure that at the beginning of the development of these platforms of social media, anybody ever gave thought to these disastrous outcomes. And so I think the fact that we are now designing this, intermediary or this mechanism with at this sort of evolutionary stage of the development of the data ecosystem is an advantage in that we know what harms we want to sort of think of overcoming. Does that mean new harms won't develop in the future? Not necessarily. But at least now we know what harms we want to overcome and basically a little bit better what tools we have at our disposal or we need to create to overcome these particular harms.
Thank you. So we have a question from Dana. Fabiana, are you still with us? Okay. So
yes, I am.
Perfecto. Okay, so we will hear from Dana and then Fabiana, okay?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's really interesting. I have a question that I'm like contemplating with myself whether to ask, but I'm wondering if what we want the intermediaries in order to have them work in a certain way. So why shouldn't we just demand the platforms to work in that way? I mean, what is the role of the intermediary?
To a certain extent, we get to design, we get to create its incentives, we get to make sure that it preserves privacy, you know, using the tools that we think that are important for or helpful or effective in preserving privacy. We get to create its incentives, and again, sort of the answer to Yuval, we get to introduce a body into the data ecosystem that changes the structure of power, that restructures, you know, the relationship between each individual, which will now be collectively individuals, vis-a-vis the platforms.
I would say sort of philosophically, I have kind of two reasons to avoid trying to do this in the framework of the existing platforms. One of them is because I think that approach ends up kind of always two steps behind in some sort of game of catch up, where if what you want to do is you want to say, oh, no, platforms, you can't do it this way, you have to do it that way. You're going to have to give a reason. When are you going to know there's a reason? Once you've already seen the harm. When do you see the harm? Long after it's already started to occur. And so there's going to be this sort of gap of, okay, now we see there's a problem here. I mean, this is how regulation is currently running. I mean, and we see how well we're doing at preventing the harm. So this is the approach that we're already doing. We're trying to make the platforms behave using regulation. We see that we sort of end up two steps behind at best. And the other one is just this sort of the economic interests of the platforms are just so divergent from the interests that we're trying to promote in this discussion that I just don't have a lot of hope for sort of forcing those two together and making them live in harmony.
Thank you very much. And apologies, I jinxed myself when I asked Fabiana if she's still here. My internet crashed eventually.
Yes, yes, I'm still there.
Perfect. Fabiana, for those who don't know, visited us in Jerusalem. So bienvenuti a casa, Fabiana, and please. Yeah.
I wish I were there, but I'm at the airport now. So I just want to add some piece of knowledge. I don't know whether you are aware of a piece of legislation which is in the pipeline in Europe and which is that Data Governance Act. It is a proposal which is concerned with fostering data circulation, and it is referring to both personal and non-personal data, and it concerns circulation of data through data. In which I had more time to discuss this vision, but I think it is really interesting to take a look at it, because its intent is to, let's say, provide different forms of governance for fostering circulation of data in ways that are different from big platforms. And therefore, not only you have the possibilities of having data circulating through the aids of intermediaries and cooperatives, but also through data altruism, which is having big silos where you can just donate data and people can use those data, reuse those data in order to, let's say, produce more services. The whole idea of the Data Governance Act is that because Europe is just too small to compete at the global level, they want to foster cooperation in order to enhance data circulation at this at the closest level. I mean, at the level which is closest to the to where data is produced. So therefore, industry data, once it is produced, it should be reused as soon as possible. And the same is true with data that is produced by individuals. This is the reason why co-ops or corporations and intermediaries should be allowed and constituted by firms, the same firms that actually produce those data. And unfortunately, now I have to embark and I cannot talk more or longer about that. But if you, I think it, that is an interesting stuff that you should look at. That's it. And congratulations for your work.
Bye-bye. Good to see you. I'm sorry that we lose you now, but yes, this is a wonderful pointer and definitely worth integrating more into the discussion that we provide. But thank you. Have a safe flight.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Okay, so we have exhausted the list of questions, which looked like we will, which was very, very long, as this is very thought-provoking and very new novel. And it seems to me that we will need to rediscuss this issue again, right? Once things will crystallize into a coherent theory. I want to thank Ayelet and Katrina for a very illuminating presentation and discussion. It was very interesting. I want to thank all of the guests that joined us today. It was lovely to have you here. You're always welcome. And hopefully one day, inshallah, in Jerusalem as well. And enjoy the rest of your morning, noon, or afternoon, wherever you are. Thank you very much.
I just
much.
Want to add that we will have a new draft available soon. If any of you are willing to read and comment, we would be extremely grateful if you could drop either of us a mail. We will be very, very glad to get your additional feedback. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you. Ayelet?
Thank you, everybody, for your comments.
Thank you very much. Until next time.
Bye, Tada.
Thanks, bye-bye. And bye-bye.